This talk is mainly about payments processing. Payments processing is about money mostly. And we in payments processing ensure that the payments that our customers send us are correctly handled and executed. I work at ING Bank. ING Bank is the biggest bank in the Netherlands. We have 14,000 employees in the Netherlands. We have 8 million plus private customers and 590,000 business customers. And essentially, we're an IT company with a banking license. This talk is targeted and centered around the clearing and settlement hub. And what it does is that it routes all payments that come in the bank and go out the bank, we route them to the correct destination. And destinations in payment processing are clearing and settlement mechanisms. And we have two key players here in Europe, that's EBA and that is Equens. So what happens if you create a payment, for example, in MyING? Well, when you select that payment and you authorize it, what happens is that that payment system creates a payment initiation request. And at the end, that ends up in an XML called a POX8. POX8 is what we call a SEPA credit transfer. That basically tells you move an X amount of money in euros from this account to another account. So if that order is within ING, then ING handles it themselves and we don't set them out. It's internally debited and credited on accounts and we don't send it to the clearing and settlement hub. But if you are an ING customer and you send a payment to ABN AMRO, at the end, that payment order will be sent by the payment processor to the clearing and settlement hub. For parties that let ING handle the payments, big companies, other banks also do that. That's called a financial institution. They also send us payments. And what the clearing and settlement hub does is that it packs all those payments, it collects them, it sends them to either EBA or Equens according to a set of rules. And if that is done, we create a file and send them to the clearing and settlement mechanism. Now, the files have certain names. There's a credit file, credit cancellation file, and a credit validation file. Those are the names of the files that we get back from them. Why is this done in this way? It's because banks have certain preferences for certain clearing and settlement mechanism. And clearing and settlement mechanism have their own set of rules. So what started this whole journey for us? We started with the fact that we have lots of payments that we need to process. That's millions of day and they come in high volumes. We do batch processing. If you do an automatic mortgage transfer to pay your mortgage every month, that payment is created at a certain point and sent to be executed. That comes in peaks, so we have a lot of peak loads. And transactions also move around a lot within the banks. They go from the payment order to internal systems, do fraud checks, and most systems have their own format in amount they want to receive data. If you send data to of a payment to ABN, it goes in an XML called a POX8. That's the SEPA credit transfer. If you send money to the US, it gets done in a different format. It's called NT. So the current settlement hub also needs to do a lot of data transfers. And within payments processing, there is no room for errors. If you have an error and you don't process the payment correctly, you're going to have customers that don't get the salary payment, are not able to go to a store and purchase something. So there's a high demand that this is done good, fast, and correctly. And at the end, we wanted to go for a reactive system because it has a lot of benefits. And at the end, we have chosen AKKA as our implementation. So this presentation will have some details that are centered around AKKA. So why go reactive in the first place? Because it's a new buzzword, so to say. And why did we settle for a reactive system? The main reasons, and I've listed them a bit in order, is the fact it is message driven. It's a different mindset. That message-driven part also makes all the components loosely coupled because you can only do things when you exchange messages. And failure is a first-class citizen. So if things fail, it's just an event, like any other event. Failure is not that catastrophic event. It's not a big disaster. It's just something that has happened in the system that didn't go as expected, and you deal with it like you deal with any other processing within the application. And because it's message-driven and loosely coupled, it's also responsive, it's resilient, it's elastic, and by nature, it also has back pressure. So you can never process more than you can actually handle. And that basically prevents your system from being overloaded when you get too much data. You can basically say, no, don't send me any more data because I'm not done processing the other data yet. So how does the CSH reactive system look like? We get data either to JMS or files. There's some other ways, but those are the two main. And if we get data, we chop it up in pieces. It's usually XML, so we chop it up in tags and data and attributes. We parse them. Does every opening XML tag have a closing tag? If that is not the case, then we consider the payment to be an error. And at the end, we check the XML if it's valid. Because sometimes you have data in an XML tag, but the data is not correct. If you have a BIC, that's a bank identifier code, or an IBAN number, it needs to be in a certain format. If it doesn't validate, so the IBAN is wrong or the BIC is wrong, that validation step will fail. And if everything checks out, the data gets sent to the message router. This whole part is a reactive stream. I will get back to that later. And a message router basically assures that payments get sent to the right party, because certain payments can only be processed by Equens, certain payments can only be processed by EBA, and some payments go to a third-party system. And payments at the end up in a file, and that file is what we call a batch. And a batch has a number of properties. One of them is that the batch is split up in box, and box can only contain one payment type. So I already mentioned the PAX 8, that's the credit transfer. You can only put PAX 8 in one box. If you need to return money because, for example, the account where you want to transfer money to doesn't exist anymore, you get a PAX 4 as a payment type. And if you want to mix them, you cannot mix them in one bulk. It needs to be of the same type. EBA allows you to have multiple bulks in a file. So you can have a PAX 8 and a PAX 4 in a file. Equens does not allow that. So every clearing and settlement mechanism has its own set of rules. And at the end, the transactions end up in a transaction handler where they're persistent, and to make sure that it's done in a manageable way, because messages cannot get too big and we need to process smaller chunks because it's easier for error handling, we do them in slices, and then slices 100 transactions. And at the end, we need to do quite some housekeeping. If we have a file that we need to keep track of it. Did we actually transfer that file to the other party? Because we do use XFB, it's kind of FTP, but then a bit more advanced. Did we really send them out? If we send out the file, we expect a response within, in our case, half an hour. Did we actually get that response? If not, we need to alert on that. If we get a response, did any of the transactions get rejected? Because we need to deal with them in a specific way. And there's all kind of housekeeping needs to be done, which is basically done by the coordinator and the tracker. And at the end, we output files. That's basically essentially what we do. So in order to make this all work, we need to have error handling in a very resilient way. And we use neighbor watching for that. And that basically means that these blocks are all JVM. So we have, in this case, four of them, that every actor, which that's what the orange blocks represent, is watched by somebody else, preferable on a different JVM. So that if things fail, we can reliably detect that failure. Because if a whole JVM disappears, it's gone and it doesn't respond anymore. And you need to make sure that if things fail, you need to be aware of that. And being aware is sometimes more important than actually correctly handling that error. And at the end, when designing the system and implement it over the years that we took to implement it, we came up with a list of things that we must do and must have. And that's a very strict list. It all makes sense. But these are all based on the very hard lessons that we learned on when implementing and running this system. One of the key components is that make all internal operations idempotent. And why? Because that you basically you can retry the operation without having all kind of nasty side effects. If you try to execute something and it fails or you don't get a response at all, you can just retry the whole operation. If it's already done that operation, you know for sure that it's not done again and it doesn't have side effects. If you execute a payment and you don't get a response and you try to execute the payment again, you want to make sure at the end that payment is executed once and not twice. So make every operation idempotent. If you, like us, settle on Akka, use Akka's reactive stream implementation. It's called Apaka. It's a really amazing piece of software and it gives you a lot of implementations out of the box, all done with a very consistent API. And I'll get back on Apaka later on. If you have failure, don't make the retry or recovery logic very complex. Just stop what you're doing, let your watcher deal with this, and let essentially we stop the operation and recreate everything from scratch again and retry the whole operation. And while it's very simple and it might give a little bit of overhead, it makes it very reliable and bulletproof. And if you do payments processing, that's pretty much what you need. If you use Akka, it also has patterns.ask, which basically means you send a message and you expect a response back. And for one-on-one operation, that's fine. But if you, in our case, need to target a lot of different components in that system because you want to write out a file, you need to collect all the transactions in that, it's not very suitable anymore. I'll also get back on later, but if you need to have an operation that talks to multiple actors, don't use it. And you need to design for eventual consistency because it's a distributed system and the eventual consistent by nature. And you need to design for that. Things don't happen at the time that you expect them. It can happen later and it can also happen much later. And you need to deal with it. So at the end in CSH, we need to keep some state. I already told you about the trackers and the administrative work that we need to do. We need to keep track of a file that we are either collecting data for or that we already sent out. We need to keep track of its state. And feedback and messages can arrive on every member of that cluster. So in order to make sure that that state is globally available in the cluster, we use distributed data. And we use Akka's version of that. And it allows us to keep state without a single point of failure. So the state is distributed around the whole cluster. It's based on conflict-free replicated data types, which gives you the guarantee that it's eventually consistent. And that if you have conflicting operations, you always end up in a correct state. That's the guarantee it gives you. And I underlined it very explicitly, but due to the fact that it's eventually consistent, you can get out the data if you read it. And that's something that you really need to take care of, and you need to expect that it can happen. So how do we deal with that? You distribute the data, you need to somehow read it, and sometimes you need to update it. And we decided to keep a local copy because it prevents some race conditions, which are specific to Akka's implementation and the way that our system is built. So if we get an update on the data, we get a replicated or changed event. And what they basically do is it gives you a complete set of new data wrapped in Scala collections, which by default are immutable. So we need to rewrap them in a Java collection if we can mutate internally, because that's in some cases what we need. And that local copy allows us to prevent a lot of reads to the distributed data. And that's basically essential to, like I said, prevent race conditions and also to make it fast. I already mentioned Apaka, that's Akka's Reactive Streams implementation. Reactive Streams are a new thing in Java 9 and above. And it gives you a way to deal with streaming data. Streaming data in that implementation always originates at a source, and the endpoint is a sink. And in between, you can map data and do operations on them. And what Apaka gives you is a lot of connectivity options out of the box already implemented and tested. If you want to read a file, there's an implementation for that. If you want to make an HTTP call, there's an implementation for that. Read an S3 bucket and update it, there's an implementation for that. Want to use Google PubSub? It's there. Everything that you most likely will need when designing an application is already present in Apaka as a source and a sync implementation. And everything that you need to do in between is already present and there. So if you write code with that, how does it look? Well, this is a very simple example already set. There's a source. In this case, we read messages from a queue called ING. We get some internal structure. And we basically say, we read the data from that consumer. We make a byte string out of that. Then that byte string is then indexed. Sequentially indexed with zip with index. So you get a byte string with a long, and that long it just increments. And then we say for every element that you get in, we do a certain operation. In this case, it's asynchronous and not ordered, because in this example, we don't care about ordering. And what we basically say is that byte string, we make it into a new reactive stream, and we write it to a file with a certain name, target out that sequence number that we got with the zip index, and we write it to a text file. And at the end, this whole description is just a blueprint which you can easily share, serialize, store on disk, whatever you want to do with it. But in order to make it work, you need to materialize it and run it. So when you materialize it, it actually gets to work and does whatever you need to do. So this, and eventually takes every JMS message and puts it in a separate file. This is essentially what this little code sample does. Of course, this is a code sample, so it doesn't really represent something that's in production. And this is basically a part of how the reactive streams look like. That is basically the whole parsing, lexing, validating step. It's not the actual code, but it's pretty similar to what we actually use. So we read messages, we create a lot of logging, we make an XML into an internal POJO format, which in our case is protobuf. We create more logging because we are a bank, we like to keep track of everything we do, so we log a lot. We update some counters because we also like metrics a lot. At the end, we do a duplicate check because duplicates basically means it needs to be processed twice and we don't want that. We determine which clearing and settlement mechanism do we need to send the payments to, because there's a whole set of rules, hundreds of them. And at the end, we send them and we batch them and we say everything is okay. So it basically allows you to chop your whole operation into tiny, reusable, easily testable steps. And with reactive streams, you automatically get back pressure for free. So if the batching flow is slow because you have a slow backend database, as long as you don't acknowledge things, you will not get more data, which allows you to prevent your system from overflowing internally, which for our case is very important, because if we overflow, we we cannot process anymore, or we do the wrong things and we miss out on payments, which simply cannot happen. So Alpaca really gives us an opportunity to create reactive streams with reusable components, with already a lot of tested components that we can just use out of the box. A second part that we really doubt is when we write a file, we need to collect all the transactions. We can easily put 400,000 in a single file, and we have chunks of transactions of 100 that are in memory. So in order to write a file, we need to collect all of them. And that collecting data is just a message, so we can get them, and you can, of course, combine all the patterns.ask, and then complete of them in them is one single operation. That's essentially what this code snippet does. You fire away a lot of requests asynchronously, and you wait until all the features complete. But that has one big downside. It's a big bang operation. It's either everything or you get nothing. And you cannot retry it partially because the code doesn't allow you to do so. So if your system is loaded and you need to do this kind of operations, there's a bigger chance that it will fail and you need to retry the whole operation. You need to, if you do one or two requests and you need to wait for an answer, it's pretty okay. But in our case, it's sometimes 6,000 or 7,000 messages where we need an answer on in order to complete the whole operation. So this really doesn't work. This will is not simple bulletproof. It fails a lot actually. So how do you deal with this? We use a very simple loop. We have a list of work actors that we need to get a response from. We send a request and we keep two lists. We keep a standard Java list where we already get a response. It's indexed based on the request that we send out. And then we just, if there's no response for a certain request, we just fire it in a loop. We just fire it, we go to all the data that we need to send out, and we at the end just collect the data as a separate message. Then after a certain time, we get a message again because it's essentially an internal timer. And we then just go over the list of responses that we get. If we already got them, we don't send them again. If we don't get a response yet, we fire them. And this is also the main reason why your operations need to be either potent. Because it could be that at the time that you already sent out that request, you already just timely get a response in. So you cannot always detect that. It's an asynchronous, eventually consistent system. So that happens. And you need to, in this case, deal with it. If we get a response back, we just store it again because the operation is idempotent, the data is always guaranteed to be the same. So even if we get a response two or three times, in this case, we don't care. We just, at the end, want all the data that we expect to be collected within a global timeout. And if that happens, we consider the operation complete. In this case, we cancel all outstanding responses because we can even get this operation as a whole. We can get it multiple times and then we send a response. This operation, how simple it looks, is very, very, very bulletproof. It has almost zero failure rate. So instead of doing patterns.ask and then completing all the whole set of features, you just do a simple loop like this. So at the end, we design a system. It does all the payments for ING that come in and come out. And the good part, it's in production. And it sounds like a lot, but within a bank, if it's in the production, that's a huge milestone. Performance is very good because it's a reactive system by design. And the main factors that make it not perform amazing is usually things like underlying database, networks, network speeds. And performance is very good and scaling is nearly linear. So if you have four machines, you get performance X. If you add four machines to it, you get 2x X as a performance. And a reactive system at the end gets a very maintainable code base because we just test the actors individually. We send them a message, we expect a certain response. We send a message, a certain set of operations out of bound, we expect a certain response. And so we just test kind of the interface. We don't test the actual implementation, which makes it very maintainable and very easy to read. The bad thing is that we did some very bad error handling in some cases. In some cases, instead of if things fail, we just ignore the failure, continued, and then bad things happened because we didn't get all the data and we said, hey, everything's okay. Well, it was not. So we did got into some serious issues because of that. Everything is asynchronous and eventually consistent. And you really need to think about it and wrap your head around that. It's not method A calls method B, calls method C. If you send out messages A, B, and C, you don't get an answer in that particular order. Your order might be C, A, B. So you need to deal with the fact that you order doesn't really exist in a distributed system. And the neighbor watch doesn't really cover all cases. Complete JVMs can go down because you lose network connectivity or the VM on which it runs crashed. So you also need to deal with that. You need to determine what data was on the JVM and how do I recover it. And that is also a very large part of the recovery code that we have. So at the end, we have a conclusion. Reactive systems require a mind shift. You need to think in messages. Everything is a message. It's not a functional system anymore where you just call a function in a library. It's you send it a message and you get a response or not. Some cases you do fire and forget. But that requires a mind shift. It actually delivers what it promises if you design it well and you keep yourself to a certain set of guidelines, you will get a responsive high-performance system. Because it's message-driven, it adds some complexity. You get a lot of POJOs in your code. You have a request, you have a response, and usually also have an error version of the response. So that's usually three Java classes that you need to deal with. We use Lombok to do automatic generation because it's a waste of time to do it by hand. But it does add some complexity. And testing is really, really, really important. Things need to be tested in the final situation. If you have a reactive system, test it with multiple systems in a cluster mode, because on the single node, it behaves differently than you have a multi-node setup. And test that. Test it right from the beginning. Don't wait until the end that you go to production and then say, hey, okay, let's now go to multi-node. Don't do that. So if you have questions, there's a 10-minute session after this one. I'm on Twitter. I'm very active on Twitter. I'm on LinkedIn. Feel free to connect. And we will go to the question round right now. After it's done, please rate my talk in the official J4 app, and we'll talk to you in our question session.
Right. So can you take a pick of a question you would like to elaborate a bit on?
Yeah, I think for the XML part, we use indeed the regular JaxxB schema validation. For the bigger files, we actually just parse it and validate it by hand, because if you run into large files, it doesn't really work because it's a blocking operation and you don't want to have it in a non-blocking system. I need to move upstairs a bit. I think so. That's the most part, and mostly the validations in our code are actually generated. So the check for an IBAN is not actually an XSD check, but it's just a piece of code that gets generated. And then does a normal validation in code. So we just check it with generated code.
Okay. So and earlier there was a question raised on how did you convince to use this type of tech instead of the proven technology that was around, and how did you prove the quality of the work?
The convincing wasn't that hard because we have pretty much authority as teams itself. It already helped that it's already pretty active within ING as a community. So that makes the discussion with management a lot easier. Yeah, and we needed to replace a mainframe system, a legacy mainframe system. So that also makes it easier to discuss about it.
Right, and there was a question on back pressure, because back pressure forces the producer to slow down. And
yes,
that means that overflow becomes someone else's problem. And how do you handle that with your streaming solution?
We don't really handle that because we are usually the consumer in a lot of things. So we don't produce a lot of messages. We do call a couple of APIs. Most of them, if that fails and we hit back pressure, we just scale down ourselves. If that fails, then in some cases, we just retry the operations. In one particular case, we fail because we cannot continue processing in that case. So in our case, it's usually not a problem. It's usually the legacy system that talks to us that needs to properly deal with it. And they don't always do that. So in some cases, we just opt to have JMS queues in between them that act as a buffer in case we can't keep up. That's rarely the case because we average about 10% CPU load for all of ING's payments at the moment. So we have lots of wiggle room to actually deal with this.
Right, and there was also a question on how to perform a check of having enough money in your account when you're dealing with eventual consistency, which I found very interesting. So,
by the time that we get them, the balance check is already done. Banks work with reservations, so before you actually send out a payment, at the time that you hit the button, a reservation in your account is made. So as long as the payment is in flight and is not processed, that reservation will be there. As soon as the other banks confirm that you get a payment in, that reservation is canceled and the booking is made final. So you can never give out more money than you actually have, because if you just do four payments, then you get four reservations. If the account stacks out to be negative for the reservation, we just reject the payment. Because in that case, we cannot process it because you don't have enough balance. And that's within a bank just a reason to reject the payment.
Right. And I have a question as well. So how do you deal with the steep learning curve for reactive programming?
I think you just have to deal with it. I think the biggest mistake we actually made is not having tested cluster mode fast enough. That really bites us in the end, because things just happen out of order with multiple JVMs. So my advice is test it in cluster mode as soon as you can, because then you'll actually learn how it behaves in reality. Yeah, and you have to wrap your head around the fact that things don't always go as expected. It's eventually consistent. Distributed data might be outdated, nodes dropping off. So by the time they get back to the cluster, they might not have data at all. But you need to make sure that that is not a big problem. In our case, when the data map is not consistent, we might actually create more files than we actually should. That is functionally not an issue because the bank doesn't really care if you send out the payments in one file or in 20 files, as long as you don't exceed certain limits. But we never do. For this case, we sacrificed eventual consistency by just raw performance.
Okay, so I just saw a new question pop up. Do you use something like Kubernetes in combination with Akka?
We don't use it yet because the Kubernetes implementation in ING lacks certain things that we really need. You could use it. There's actually a piece of documentation on the Akka site that actually deals with this. And the biggest challenge is that the fact that the network setup in Kubernetes is a bit awkward. So you need to configure certain things for that. But if you use Akka cluster bootstrap, that has Kubernetes integration integrated in that. So you can just tell it, hey, this is a Kubernetes cluster. Please do whatever you need to do with it. And I don't want to know about it. So if you just configure that and you specify the right things, then everything gets taken care of.
Okay, one final question. If you had free reign, what other banking processes would you like to apply reactive streams to?
I think most of them, actually. Maybe clean APIs, not so much. think that's a bit of overkill. But I think also on payments processing itself, core processing, where you need to do the bookings and the processing and reservations, these kind of things, it actually quite suited, especially the message-driven part. It's sometimes a big pain in the ass, so to say, because you have a lot of things you need to deal with. There's a steep learning curve, but at the end, it actually pays off. Because you get a very well-tested, scalable system, and other systems simply don't give you that out of the box.
Okay, so thank you very much. Our time is out. Okay. Thank you very much for an interesting talk.
Thank you. Okay, thank you.
And thank
if you
for
have questions,
audience.
then let me know. I'm online the whole evening.
Okay, enjoy the rest of J4.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Are you an innovator? This man is. I would like to introduce you to Santiago.
Hi.
One of our IT specialists.
This is Marta's one.
Are you sure about that? Well, you really need a good IT background to succeed in an IT role within ING. But besides that, you also need people skills.
I have the best people skills.
Okay. Yes, it is a dynamic environment where you combine your latest knowledge on trends in the market, the banking industry, and state-of-the-art technology.
Here, we work with colleagues from very different disciplines and backgrounds. We think out of the box and focus on solving real problems. For me, that's where the magic happens. I'm helping my initiative to embed cybersecurity in every step of their development, making them compliant and secure. It has the flair of a startup and the advantages of a big company.